When it comes to the search for life on Mars, we might be looking in the wrong place. Recently, I was asked by Timothy Walter on Patreon about the most likely places in the solar system to find life outside of Earth. Mars is certainly a contender. In the first billion or so years of its existence, Mars was in many ways similar to Earth, and it's entirely possible that life could have emerged on its surface before the planet underwent changes that made Mars much less hospitable. That's why NASA rovers such as Perseverance are investigating places like Jezero Crater, to investigate those dried up deltas for any evidence that life might have once flourished there. But as I looked deeper into the topic, it struck me that this might not be the most likely home for life on Mars. There is another location that is an even more likely contender for life. And incredibly, that life, if there, might even still be alive to this day. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum Answers, the series where we take questions you post to us on Patreon and uncover the answers. And today, we're going deeper than ever before, into a world where a deep biosphere might thrive. I'm going to answer where I think is the most likely place to find life on the planet Mars. When it comes to life forming though, we should probably start at the beginning. It's worth recognizing that we're going to get a little speculative for this video, as there are many aspects of the origin of life even on Earth that are right now still unknown. I did a video recently on how life likely first came to be, and one of its key points is that there's still a lot of debates over the specifics. It's also worth noting that we do not know for certain that life does exist or ever existed on Mars at all. But there is some evidence that is intriguing. NASA's Curiosity rover has detected methane in Mars's atmosphere, which mysteriously only emerges at night and is strangely absent during the day. Methane on Earth is mostly produced by living organisms, so it's an intriguing indication that life might be on Mars too. However, this is not definitive proof, as there are also non-organic ways to make methane, as I talk about in one of my other videos on life on other planets. So then, why do scientists think that Mars might be, or used to be, the home for life in the first place? It's all thanks to what Mars looked like in the first billion or so years after it formed. According to our best theories of how life first came to be on Earth, there are some key things that you need. Water, for one. All life on Earth seems to need it. But also mechanisms for producing diverse and complex chemical structures, the raw building blocks of life from which protocells could arise. Something like a deep sea thermal vent would help with that, or possibly a volcanic hot spring, as they would release a nice spew of minerals and chemicals that could then hopefully be formed into very basic protocells if conditions were just right. Finally, on the note of those conditions, you need some kind of selective pressure to choose some chemical structures and discard others. This is quite similar to evolution, in that it wouldn't work if there wasn't a selective pressure to guide it. For animals, this could be a scarcity of food encouraging the survival of those best able to locate it. But for chemical structures, it could be something like a cyclical environment that is sometimes wet and sometimes dry, testing to see if certain structures can survive those kinds of changes. The structures that break apart when faced with this stress test are selected out, while those that survive can move on to the next round of selection. A sort of evolution, but for rocks. On Earth, evidence suggests that life arose within the first billion years after the planet formed, which is quite fast on the cosmic scale of things. And it turns out that on Mars, its first billion years of existence had these key factors and more. It also had a thick atmosphere and a magnetic field to protect any fledgling life from deadly solar radiation and to allow bodies of liquid water to form without evaporating away. It had volcanism, providing energy from the planet's warm core, and those vital chemical building blocks. Sunlight also provided helpful energy to the planet. If the presence of these things on Earth made it urable, meaning capable of supporting the genesis of life, then it could well make Mars urable too, However, there's a built-in time limit here. After 1 to 2 billion years, the water had all dried up. Mars had cooled enough that the mechanism powering its magnetic field had ceased. And over just a few hundred million years later, the atmosphere had been stripped away. This eventually led to the evaporation of all the liquid water on the planet, with the only remaining water being locked in the ice on the polar caps. So life on Mars would need to have formed during those 1 to 2 billion years after the planet's formation. NASA is working under the assumption that this is the case, and so they've sent rovers and landers to investigate craters like Jezero for any ancient signs of life. Perseverance has collected 21 rock core samples as of April 2024, which it got from drilling a few centimeters into the stony surface of Mars. Jezero crater once held a large body of water and a delta. If living things had made that water a habitat, their remains could well have dropped into the bottom of the delta to be captured in the sediment there. There is even a chance that they're still locked into that sediment. Researchers in the journal Astrobiology found that even when completely dried up, frozen, and subjected to intense radiation, certain kinds of bacteria on Earth could theoretically survive hundreds of millions of years without too much ill effect, just waiting to be thawed out and given water again. This is why scientists must be so careful about both forwards and backwards cross-contamination when exploring other worlds. If not there, there is also a chance that life exists in the water lakes on Mars today. But Alex, I hear you say through your screens, didn't you just tell us that those lakes had all dried up? What I told you was mostly true, but not entirely. While it seems unlikely that there is any water still moving freely on Mars' surface, there is a location where water can still be found, and in liquid form, deep beneath the polar caps. In 2018, scientists announced that they had found an entire lake trapped deep beneath the thick ice. Three more were confirmed by 2020. This is interesting because it mirrors an ecosystem on Earth called Lake Vostok, which is also a lake sealed away 4 kilometers beneath the solar polar ice cap. Intriguingly, Lake Vostok was found in the late 90s to house bacteria and even potentially fish. Some trace DNA was captured and brought to the surface. Either way, Lake Vostok is a fascinating ecosystem that has been sealed away for 15 to 25 million years. Sadly, the chance of Mars' lake being another Lake Vostok filled with ancient life is actually quite low. Given the temperatures on Mars being so much lower, it's thought that the water inside the polar lakes there have to be very salty. This would not be conducive for most forms of life. And on top of that, perhaps the Martian lakes are not real after all. A recent study in the journal Science Advances offered other explanations for why the radar imaging thought it saw a lake, suggesting that reflective dust layers spaced closely together could create the same effect, a sort of optical illusion. If this is what's happening on Mars, the lakes might not even be there. So, it seems that Jezero crater is a better place to search. But even Jezero has a point against it. Jezero crater, while certainly habitable, is not a likely place where life could have formed. It does not contain deep thermal vents and isn't home to volcanic springs, unlike other parts of the planet like Columbia Hills. So the question is, could life have formed and then distributed quickly enough that it would make it to craters like Jezero before Mars underwent its transformation into a barren world? It's possible, but it's also possible that it would not. As the planet cooled and the water evaporated, any bodies of water would have found themselves becoming more and more salty, as any salt concentration would have ended up with a lower and lower ratio of water. Again, too much salt is bad for most forms of life, and research suggests it could have been a massive hurdle for the survival of undeveloped protocells. Such cells simply may not have developed the tools to allow them to survive in such conditions. Even more developed Earth life would have struggled when combined with the depleting atmosphere and deadly radiation. So it's safer to search where life would have begun rather than places it would have distributed. Thus, volcanic spring sites like Columbia Hills already seem like a better place to look for signs of early life than Jezero Crater. If life never made it out of the primordial soup on Mars, those initial pools are the places that make the most sense to look, as so far, we're not looking there. But if you want to talk about where life on Mars might be right now, volcanic springs have one other vital feature going for them. They are gateways to underground biomes. Why explore out of the water when you can follow those nutrients down to their source? On Earth, life does not just live on the surface. There exists a whole world of life known as the deep biosphere that exists kilometers beneath our feet. Life down there has learned to adapt to living without sunlight and without air, in high temperature and high pressure environments. And incredibly, it's thriving. In 2018, Deep Carbon Observatory collaborators, a group of over 1,000 scientists, published that if you added up all the weight of the living things beneath the surface of Earth, it would add up to almost 400 times the carbon mass of every human on the planet combined. The deep biosphere covers an area of nearly 2.3 billion cubic kilometers, almost twice the volume of all the oceans. It contains 70% of all species of Earth's bacteria and archaea. Also, viruses and small worms have been found down there. Overall, it is thought to be as diverse, if not more diverse, than the surface. There has not yet been found a limit to how deep or how hot life can survive, as records are continually being broken. Currently, the hottest survived temperature is 121 degrees Celsius, hot enough to boil water, which was found with a bacterium living in a thermal vent. And the deepest is 10.5 kilometers beneath the sea level. Food is hard to come by when you're kilometers deep in rock, and metabolic processes of living things in the deep biosphere is 10,000 to 1 million times slower than the surface. With life ticking so slowly, it transpires that they can live almost indefinitely. We don't yet know how old things get down there. Some species are found at sites globally, suggesting that although they're traveling through solid rock to do so, bacteria are still somehow able to get around. We've only in the last decade begun to grasp the sheer scale of the deep biosphere on Earth, but all of this is incredibly insightful when it comes to life on Mars. Deep beneath Mars's surface, life could be well protected from any of the devastation going on at its surface. Life is proven to be able to survive thermal vents, which means that once life formed in a volcanic region, it would have been able to seep into the warmer, nutrient-rich subsurface through cracks. It simply would have had to fall down. And given the long metabolisms involved, it could still be alive there today. There could be a thriving, widespread ecosystem alive and well. Finding out for sure would be difficult. We find it hard to explore the deep biosphere here on Earth, requiring deep sea drilling technology or very deep mines. On Mars, landers like InSight struggle to even dig 2 to 3 centimeters. But to my mind, that's the most likely place to search for Martian life today. Of course, it's worth reiterating that there are a lot of ifs here. If life formed on Mars in the first place, if it managed to make it out of the hot springs it likely formed in, if it evolved and adapted like it did on Earth, only then could it still be out there. But it's incredible to me to consider that while Mars's surface might appear dry and barren, there's the potential for an entire thriving ecosystem beneath Mars's soil, alive today. Perhaps that is the cause for the methane in Mars's atmosphere, detected by Curiosity. There's always a chance life spread to lakes like Jezero, but my bet, if it's alive today, it will be deeper. I believe that when it comes to finding life on Mars, we've barely scratched the surface. Do you have a question you'd like us to answer? Send it over to us on Patreon, and you might be selected for a future Astrum Answers episode. But for now, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. When you have 5 minutes to spare in your day, what do you do with it? One common practice is to get out your phone and scroll through social media. However, if you're anything like me, scrolling through the infinite supply of new information somehow never quite manages to satisfy, and it's not something I feel great about. If this is the same for you, then you might enjoy the sponsor of today's video, Imprint. Imprint is a different way to turn breaks in your day into a habit of learning. It's an app brimming with bite-sized courses and quick reads about philosophy, science, business, history, health, and more. The feeling you get from learning daily feels much more satisfying than doom scrolling, and I enjoy what it teaches me about the wider world. See for yourself, the first 200 fans will get a free trial and 20% off an annual subscription to Imprint's award-winning app when you scan my QR code or click imprintapp.com/Astrum in the description below. Get started today. Thanks for watching. And thanks to our crew of Astrumnauts over at Patreon, who help us make science knowledge freely available to everyone. Chasing the algorithm can be hit and miss sometimes, so your contributions help us keep making the content we love. And if you haven't already, but you want to join the Patreon, there's never been a better time to get in on the party. Just sign up with the link in the description. When you join, you'll be able to watch the whole video ad-free, see your name in the credits, and submit questions to our team. Once again, a huge thank you from myself and the whole Astrum team. Meanwhile, click the link to this playlist for more Astrum content. I'll see you next time.